In the history of film, no actor's movies have made more money. Yet despite his fame and popularity, Harrison Ford remains a surprising study in contradiction. He chose the most public of professions, yet has remained a quiet, intensely private man, living far from the Hollywood fast lane.
I always felt a little distant from the established social order.
The contradictions abound. The man who would become the model of the on-screen hero was actually a quiet kid.
I was a bit of a nerd, I suppose.
He stumbled into acting almost by accident.
My school didn't have a course in basket weaving, so I took what I thought would be the next easiest thing, which was drama.
And although he's among the industry elite, he somehow has remained a Hollywood outsider and his own man. In the next hour, you'll meet the actor who changed the face of movies. We'll trace his remarkable journey from a suburban childhood in the American Midwest through underachieving high school years. You'll hear how the young actor was forced into B-movies and TV appearances that embarrassed him, and how Harrison Ford all but quit the business for a job working with his hands.
Fred said, "Oh, I got the perfect guy, I got the perfect guy." And he said, but he's a carpenter, he's kind of left the business, he hates the business, but I think we can get him to come back to play his part.
And you'll learn the real stories behind the roles that made him a star.
Here he was, down on his hands and knees, you know, hammering nails and hammering in woodwork, and at Zoetrope, when all these actors would be walking past him as he's down on his hands and knees.
You'll meet filmmakers with whom he's made some of the world's most popular and beloved films.
I do believe that Harrison's the closest thing we have to Bogart.
You'll hear from insiders who helped him along the way, and from co-stars who worked with and watched Harrison Ford go from nobody to cinematic everyman.
And it took him so long, and it was such a struggle for him to get there.
I think all great actors expect a lot of their fellow actors.
And in a rare, candid, and exclusive interview, Harrison Ford helps tell his own story.
I'm very happy with the way things have turned out.
This is Celebrity Profile. Harrison Ford's story begins in the hot, humid Chicago summer of 1942. On July 13th, Ford became the first of two children, both boys, born to Christopher and Dorothy Ford. Harrison Ford and kid brother Terrence, born 3 years later, grew up in and around a booming post-war Chicago, just coming into its own as the leading city of the American heartland. Their father, a dapper advertising man and former radio actor, rode the crest of an entertainment medium just being introduced to American homes.
My dad was instrumental in producing the first television commercial, which used a see-through plexiglass washing machine to demonstrate the low sudsing capacity of all washing machine powder.
Ford's mother was very much the 50s homemaker.
My mom was always around the house. I had very little idea of what she was doing when we went to school. But the house was always very nice, and we had a nice, simple family life.
His early life seemed fairly typical for those baby boomer years. One childhood ambition was to be a coal delivery man. This, of course, was when coal was still used to heat many private residences. He was a quiet boy, attending school at Graham Stewart Elementary. Like many post-war parents, Christopher and Dorothy Ford left the city behind for the suburbs. Before entering his teens, the Fords moved to this house in middle-class Morton Grove. He attended Emma Meltzer School, where he was often forced to defend himself against playground bullies. Later, the family moved to Park Ridge, where at home, Ford enjoyed some rather unusual hobbies.
At one point, I raised rats, black and white hooded rats, which are a lab animal. And I had two pet rats, and then I had 12, and then I had 100, and got out of control.
He also raised snakes. Ironic, in that as Indiana Jones many years later, he'd play a man pathologically afraid of them. By the time he entered Maine East High School in the fall of 1956, Ford's keep-to-himself nature was well developed.
I was a bit of a nerd, I suppose. I was in the model railroad club. I used to build little HO models with my father. And I was in the audiovisual club for a while because you got to be out of study hall.
However, Ford was not a loner. He had a circle of friends and dated a little. This included some double dates at Romano's, a local hangout in nearby Des Plaines. And among his many part-time jobs was repairing and selling pipes at the Evening Pipe Shop in Park Ridge. By the time he graduated Maine East with less than spectacular grades, Ford wanted out. 2 months after his 18th birthday, Ford would head north to Wisconsin, but with no clear goal. When Celebrity Profile continues, Harrison Ford goes to college.
I continued my failure academically into my college years.
But the rudderless young man found direction in a very unexpected place. And later, Ford's days as a studio contract player.
I'm gonna frame this and hang it right next to my other diploma.
Oh.
Come on, Mom, it's your turn. You gotta say something.
Yeah!
September 1960. It was 2 months before John Kennedy's election as president. An 18-year-old high school graduate, Harrison Ford, was leaving home for Ripon College, a small liberal arts school 2 hours northwest of Milwaukee. At the time, the school could point with pride to at least one famous graduate, actor Spencer Tracy, class of 1920. But no one would have predicted any future like that for the quiet kid from Chicago's northern suburbs.
Well, I was such a poor student in high school that I needed an extra bit of help getting into any college. And the director of admissions at Ripon College apparently was a ski friend of one of my teachers.
Ripon was a modest but proud school where dances, egg tosses, parades, and beer parties were part of the local culture. Ford signed up with the Sigma Nu fraternity, surprising in that he really didn't seem like a joiner. Irv Ott was one of his frat brothers.
I wouldn't say a loner by any means, but he had sort of had the personality of being an individual.
Among Ford's philosophy professors was Robert Spud Hannaford.
He seemed to find ways to amuse himself and parties and so on, the way Ripon students are likely to do, you know, play hard and maybe work hard on occasion. He could be discovered on hay rides and beer barrel parties and, you know, the usual sort of fun and games.
But if Ford liked to drink, and some also describe him as a ladies' man at the time, he wasn't much interested in his studies. And if he was looking for direction, Ford found it quite by accident.
Well, I was a philosophy and English major, and my grade point average was slipping. And my school didn't have a course in basket weaving, so I took what I thought would be the next easiest thing, which was drama. Never having realized that you were supposed to get up and act in drama class.
Eventually, Ford began to get cast in plays. At first, his stage fright was so bad that even those sitting in the back rows could see his legs shake.
It is Mr. Antrobus in Skin of Our Teeth, Thornton Wilder's play. That was the first part that I had. A pillow under my clothes and a mustache, a lot of talcum powder in my hair. I also played El Gallo in The Fantastics and Macheath in Threepenny Opera. And I think that's all I did in college, three plays.
It was enough to give Ford the acting bug. He needed something to feel passionate about, because little else at Ripon interested him. Often strapped for cash, Ford's money-making ventures included an underground paper, The Mug. His contribution was artwork for the advertisements. He admits he turned on the charm to take a variety of odd jobs.
I worked as a tree trimmer and a delivery boy for a florist, and worked in a stationery store. Worked for the telephone company. Worked on a yacht for a period of time as a steward.
Ford's lackluster interest in his studies declined further in his senior year. However, there were some bright spots. For one, his stage work. The other bright spot was his girlfriend, Mary Marquardt. Ford grew close to the demure transfer student during their senior year. Meantime, Ford's impending academic collapse would trouble his parents.
But when I flunked out 4 days before graduation, after 4 years, I'd run them out of college tuition money. I'd run the college out of patience with me.
Mary, however, did graduate. Two important things followed in the summer of 64. One involved wedding bells.
It was her family's wish that if we were going to live together, that we'd be married. It was the 60s, as far as I was concerned. And so the marriage was arranged and took place. And I considered it brave of her to marry somebody that had as few prospects as I did.
The other big summer event of 1964 was Ford's first professional acting job. It was with the Belfry Players, a repertory company in the lakeside town of Williams Bay, Wisconsin. He and Mary stayed at Belfry House, next door to the theater. Years later, Ford's picture would adorn the House Hall of Fame wall, beside the photo of another Belfry veteran, Paul Newman, summer of 49.
I did about six plays there in Summerstock. It was one of those deals where you build the sets while you're performing. It was fun, great fun. And yes, I'm sure I forgot my lines in Night of the Iguana and practically everything else that I did.
By the late fall of 64, it had begun to snow, and the newlyweds began to take stock of their prospects. Mary was fully behind her husband's dream of an acting career.
All I knew about being an actor is that you had to go to either L.A. or New York, and so we flipped a coin and it came up New York, so we made it 2 out of 3, because I didn't want to go to New York either.
Winter, 1965. Harrison and Mary Ford made the road trip so many others have taken, seeking a new life in California.
We put all of what we had in a Volkswagen Beetle and drove to Los Angeles. Sort of meandering journey along the way, exploring, and we stopped in the first place that we saw the ocean, which was Laguna Beach.
Ford landed a day job here, now a Macy's, but at the time a Bullock's department store. He was an assistant buyer of what he's called knickknacks and oil paintings. Driving Laguna Canyon one day produced something movie audiences would see for decades.
I was on my way to the Bullock's department store in one of the first cars that had a shoulder belt, an old Volvo. And I'd forgotten to put the belt on, which I never did. And while I was fumbling to get it out of its holder, my car hit a curb and went up on two wheels and went into a telephone pole. And that's where I got this.
The resulting scar on his chin would become a trademark. But Ford would not be working in retail for long.
One of the directors from the Summerstock company that I had been working with lived nearby there and introduced me to people at the Laguna Playhouse who cast me in a play.
Movie and TV veteran Ian Bernard had composed some music for the production. A dramatic reading of the Pulitzer Prize-winning poem John Brown's Body by Stephen Vincent Benet.
Well, I liked him at that time, especially because he wasn't actory. I don't know, does that mean anything? Yeah. He was very natural, very easy, and he said his lines in a very believable way.
Fate intervened when Bernard did something he's never done for anyone else before or since.
I called the head of casting at Columbia. And I said, there's a very talented young actor down here, and it's Harry Ford was his name, and would you give him an interview? And he said, send him up.
He was not, however, the first Harrison Ford to hit Hollywood. 40 years earlier, this Harrison Ford had been a major matinee idol. Even though this Harrison Ford died in 1957, his namesake was asked to find a new name. He sarcastically suggested Kurt Affair, and for a brief time, he was billed as Harrison J. Ford. In any event, Columbia signed him to a 7-year contract, starting at $150 a week.
It wasn't a lot of money, actually, but it was enough. We hadn't any children, and I was living in a $75 a month apartment. Nice one, too. The problem with the $150 a week was that they didn't really have any respect for anybody. They got that cheap, so they didn't use me, but very rarely.
Ford joined the studio's new talent program. Early on, studio types insisted on needless cosmetic changes, like airbrushing out Ford's chin scar from photographs.
We were obliged to go to acting classes every day, and we were supposed to dress nicely, and we were also expected to carry out publicity assignments, which I loathed, cavorting on the beach with starlets and weird stuff.
Producer Fred Roos, then a casting director, took a liking to Ford and became his biggest booster.
In the struggling days, he did have some anger and resentment about the system, you know, the system that actors had to go through and the studio system.
In 1966, Ford made his big screen debut in the now-forgotten caper movie Dead Heat on a Merry-Go-Round.
I played a bellboy, and my lines were paging Mr. Jones, Mr. Jones, paging Mr. Jones. And Mr. Jones was James Coburn. I was called into the head of the New Talent Program's office the next day. And he said, kid, you're never going to make it in this business. So, what occasions such a remark? He said, well, I just saw the dailies, and you're never going to make it. He said, let me tell you a story. He said, the first time Tony Curtis was ever in a film, he delivered a bag of groceries. You took one look at that guy, and you knew that that was a movie star. And I leaned across his desk, and I said, I thought you were supposed to think that that was a grocery delivery boy. And he threw me out of the office, of course. And it was the beginning of the end for me at Columbia.
Two more Columbia films lay ahead, including the forgettable Western, The Long Ride Home. In 1967, Ford was called into an executive's office to find his contract was being terminated.
Out of the goodness of his heart, going to extend my contract for 2 weeks, knowing that my wife was pregnant. And I said, gee, thanks, but I'd just as soon be out of it right now. And he got very angry at me and, of course, did let me out of my contract.
It was a classic example of Ford's unwillingness to cower or compromise. Soon after, Mary Ford gave birth to their first child, Benjamin.
The sad part of the story is that as soon as the contract was terminated, I was under contract to Universal Pictures for $250 a week. So my period in obscurity continued.
At Universal, it was more of the same, and that included a handful of TV series appearances. On the crime drama Ironside, he played a recent college graduate. Given the course of Ford's career, it now drips with irony.
I'm going to frame this and hang it right next to my other diploma.
Oh.
Come on, Mom, it's your turn. You got to say something.
Yeah, hey, you say something.
Oh, no, I just cry. Oh, you better let your father do the talking.
Well, me?
Well, come on, Dad, you heard her. Well,
what's there to say except how proud I am of him? My kid at the top of his class. How am I ever going to make a carpenter out of him now?
I'll build a stairway to the moon, Pop.
The scene is ironic, because by the late 60s, Harrison Ford was so turned off by the movie industry, he coincidentally did turn to carpentry. It began on a friendly bet. To learn the craft, Ford did the logical thing. He went to the library.
I was up on the roof of Sergio Mendez's rehearsal hall with a book from the Encino Public Library about how to cut in a roof. It worked. I also hired a few guys that knew something more about it than I did, and I learned from them as well.
One project led to another, a recording studio for music producer Mendez, a deck at the home of actress Sally Kellerman, and Fred Roos often hired him to work on his own home. In fact, thanks to a small inheritance that Mary received, the Fords bought a small fixer-upper of their own on Woodrow Wilson Drive in the Hollywood Hills. But Ford was too busy on other carpentry jobs to fix up his own home. Cindy Williams had known Ford since his contract days at Universal.
He didn't have a door on his own bathroom, and they had just put a blanket up.
It was livable, but it was an unfinished work in progress.
In 1972, Roos arranged an audition for his friend. It would be a tentative step back to movie acting. When Celebrity Profile continues, Harrison Ford turns drag racer.
Harrison, at that time, was a pretty mysterious guy.
And later, how building a studio doorway got Ford's foot in the door for the role that made him a household name.
He was there working, and I was interested in Harrison.
In 1972, Harrison Ford the carpenter was accepting only occasional acting jobs. His longtime champion, casting director Fred Roos, thought Ford would be just right for a little movie. It would be shot on a shoestring budget by an obscure writer-director named George Lucas.
Fred said, oh, I got the perfect guy. And he said, but he's a carpenter, he's kind of left the business, he hates the business, but I think we can get him to come back to play his part.
Ultimately, they did get him to come back, but only after a dispute over the union scale of $485 a week. For Ford, the issue was one of pride.
The most George and the producer, Gary Kurtz, could allow me was an extra 15. So I went back to Harris and says, well, I got 15 more dollars a week. He says, okay, I'm in.
The movie was American Graffiti, a coming-of-age tale set in 1962. For Lucas, it was a personal story, and he shot it on his home turf in Northern California. Candy Clark was among the ensemble cast of mostly unknowns.
Harrison, at that time, was a pretty mysterious guy. He was standoffish and hard to know, and he wasn't very outgoing. He was pretty quiet and brooding, kind of a James Dean kind of thing going there.
Well, not entirely. Ford, who played an amateur drag racer, got pretty wild with co-star and fellow drinking buddy Paul LaMatt.
Hey, Lori, what in the hell are you doing in there? Is she gonna ride with you?
Mind your business, John.
Yeah, she's going with me. You take care of yourself, man. Are you guys ready?
I should be telling these tales out of class, but the night that they stood on the second floor balconies at their windows and threw beer bottles out and they broke a Cadillac, the windshield of a Cadillac. I know, they were terrorists. They had us scared.
I think that's when Harrison was relegated to the Howard Johnsons in Stinson Beach. and he was lonely. He did jail time on American Graffiti at the Howard Johnsons.
Ford was the subject of many other wild stories. Among them, that he and LaMatt tossed co-star Richard Dreyfuss headfirst into the hotel pool. And Ford earned the wrath of the local police for some real-life drag racing.
We maybe got back to the start mark a little faster than we should have, but those cars were very tempting.
American Graffiti was a hit, but playing dragster Bob Falfa did not jumpstart Ford's career. The next year, he shot a small part in Francis Ford Coppola's critically acclaimed film, The Conversation. By 1975, Harrison Ford was about to become a dad again. His second son, Willard, would arrive soon. Money remained scarce, and by now, he was practically a full-time carpenter. Not that he was happy about it.
He would go through these funks, and I remember getting on the phone with him one time and saying to him, Harrison, you're like Cary Grant. Someday you're going to be there. You don't have anything to worry about. And I was making this up. I mean, I was making it up to try and help a friend through a bit of a depression. And later on, you know, I sort of like, I was so right about that, but I can't give myself any credit. I was just making it up.
That same year, George Lucas began casting his next film. He was seeing actors at Coppola's production offices at the Samuel Goldwyn Studios in Hollywood. As it was, a certain master carpenter also happened to be there installing an elaborate doorway for Coppola.
Here he was down on his hands and knees, you know, hammering nails and hammering in woodwork, and at Zoetrope, when all these actors would be walking past him as he's down on his hands and knees, and there they would be going in on parts that he, you know, should have been going in or could have done, and he felt really defeated.
The film would be unusual in that it combined elements of Greek tragedy, shoot-'em-up westerns, and outer space movie serials of the 1930s. It was, of course, Star Wars. Eventually, Ford was invited in, but not necessarily for a role.
I was asked if I would come in and help them read other actors without being told that I was being considered, and I'm not sure it was being considered.
Eventually, Lucas had to admit the perfect actor for the role of lovable rogue Han Solo was underfoot all along. Like Ford, Han Solo was hard-headed, independent, his own man. Rarely do actor and role mesh so perfectly.
Hokey religions and ancient weapons are no match for a good blaster at your side, kid.
You don't believe in the Force, do you?
Kid, I've flown from one side of this galaxy to the other. I've seen a lot of strange stuff, but I've never seen anything to make me believe there's one all-powerful force controlling everything. There's no mystical energy field controls my destiny. It's all a lot of simple tricks and nonsense.
Star Wars not only put Ford on the movie map, it also matured him as an actor.
Alec Guinness was really very kind to me. I was, of course, nervous about appearing in a film with Alec Guinness, who I considered to be one of the great film artists.
When we did Star Wars, and he was around Alec Guinness, and he was around some of these English actors, especially Alec Guinness, I think, he really saw the profession, I think, for the first time.
Star Wars launched Ford's career after years of false starts, but Harrison Ford's struggles, professional and personal, were far from over. The 1977 phenomenon that was Star Wars surprised a lot of people, including Harrison Ford himself. Henry Winkler met Ford after Star Wars was shot, but before its release.
He was smoking non-filtered cigarettes, and he couldn't sit. And he walked back and forth as he talked. And it was like he was a caged lion. And he just was intense and had an opinion about everything.
If Ford was nervous, he needn't have been. Star Wars was an international hit, and when George Lucas shared some of the huge profits with cast and crew, Harrison Ford enjoyed his first ever bit of financial breathing room. Ford's next roles were strategically chosen.
Each one was a better role than the one before. I was able to insist on better billing than the one before, so it looked like progress.
Winkler and Ford played Vietnam vets briefly reunited in Heroes. Winkler remembered their first scene together.
He gave me a bear hug and lifted me off the ground that I literally could not breathe for like about a month afterwards. He changed my entire pitch and timbre of my voice.
He co-starred with Robert Shaw in the World War II movie sequel Force 10 from Navarone, and he had a small role in Francis Ford Coppola's Vietnam epic Apocalypse Now. But while acting offers were coming in, his marriage was failing. By the late 70s, Harrison and Mary Ford apparently had drifted apart. Ford has said that extended location shooting far from home was a factor, but beyond that, this very private man has deliberately said little about the divorce, drawing a distinct line between the professional and the personal. Meantime, his post-Star Wars films were not doing well at the box office. That included the comic western, The Frisco Kid. Ford's role had been written for John Wayne, who dropped out over a salary dispute. Producer Mace Neufeld recalled that his veteran director, Robert Aldrich, had trouble accepting Ford.
While he was shooting the film with Harrison, every time he looked at Harrison, he saw John Wayne. And so he was very, very tough on Harrison.
The wartime romance Hanover Street also fared poorly. He may have been getting better billing, but Ford's career was not taking off as he'd hoped. Around that time, he received a dinner invitation in Toronto from longtime friend Fred Roos. The former casting agent had innocently invited along a screenwriter named Melissa Matheson.
I was up there producing The Black Stallion, and Melissa was our writer, one of the two writers on it, and she was on location with us, and Harrison came through on a PA promoting publicity thing. And I knew he was in town, and I just I don't know if I went along to dinner or had them go to dinner. I wasn't arranging a date, that's for sure.
Professionally, Roos may have done more than anyone else for Ford's career. Now he'd introduced his friend to the woman who'd eventually become Ford's second wife. At the start of the 1980s, Harrison Ford was an established actor with one blockbuster under his belt. That soon would change, thanks to George Lucas and the industry's other dominant filmmaker, Steven Spielberg. Ford would reunite with Lucas for two more Star Wars films. And in the midst of all this, Lucas and Spielberg cooked up Ford's next signature role. But the actor who brought Han Solo to life was not their first choice to play Indiana Jones, the mild college professor who moonlights as an archaeologist and adventurer.
Tom Selleck had the part and was all set to begin when Television Network exercised the option they held on Tom for a series. I think it was Magnum P.I.
The film was Raiders of the Lost Ark in 1981. And like the Star Wars films, it had its genesis in the rough and tumble movie serials of the 1930s. Like Han Solo, Indiana Jones was not a straightforward hero. His fear of snakes and other quirks helped form a fascinating, vulnerable, and romantic character capable of rising to every occasion. By 1983, Ford could point to the Star Wars phenomenon and the first of three Indiana Jones films. But surprisingly, his career was also hampered by those hits. Fred Roos remembers when other producers would casually seek his advice on casting questions.
And I would often suggest Harrison for... And they say, oh, he's not good with women. I can't see him in a romantic thing with women. You know, he's an action kind of a guy. The Star Wars, the Indiana Jones were really the movies were the hits. It wasn't Harrison.
So despite his success, Ford still had trouble getting respect. And there were films that failed during that time, among them Blade Runner in 1982. The grim science fiction thriller was hailed for its visuals, but little else. Ford has admitted he and director Ridley Scott didn't see eye to eye. What's worse, studio executives insisted on an explanatory narration track, which Ford disliked. 1983, however, was a pivotal year for Harrison Ford. Return of the Jedi was the third Star Wars blockbuster, and off-screen, Ford's life was moving into a new phase. He married Melissa Matheson, who'd carved her own niche in the industry by writing the screenplay for Steven Spielberg's E.T., the Extraterrestrial. The newlyweds bought a home near that of Mary Ford, so Harrison could be near his two boys. And by all accounts, relations between the two Ford families were friendly. When Celebrity Profile continues, Harrison Ford finds his own niche as one of the preeminent actors of his generation. In 1984, Harrison Ford returned to the role of Indiana Jones, facing a temple of doom alongside Kate Capshaw. A back injury during production left him almost immobilized. George Lucas flew to England and was shocked by what he found.
And he says, I don't want to let the movie down. I really don't, you know, I can do this. I said, you can't. You got to stop now. He was in unbelievable pain, much more than he would ever let on.
Eventually, Ford agreed to a 7-week break for a back operation. His fanatical work ethic and lack of ego on the set are among the reasons he's popular with co-stars and crew members alike. Producer Mace Neufeld has a long association with Ford.
He puts himself in the same category as all the other craftspeople on films, and that's who make film. You know, the cameraman, the production designer, the gaffer.
In 1985 came the thriller Witness. In the Fish Out of Water story, he played a police detective hiding out among the Pennsylvania Amish. The hint of sexual chemistry with an Amish woman, played by Kelly McGillis, helped broaden his appeal. Now, producers began to see Ford differently, according to longtime friend Fred Roos.
Witness, I think, turned that all around. I think it was a pivotal role for him.
From there, Ford built a body of work to rival that of any top film star, past or present. He brought a new maturity, plus a combination of authority and a common touch to many roles. He especially liked complex, ambiguous heroes, like the father in The Mosquito Coast, who takes his family to the jungle in a rejection of Western values. 4 years later, in 1990, there was another flawed hero, the prosecutor falsely accused of murder in Presumed Innocent.
I really enjoyed working on those characters, those films. I don't often get parts that fall into that category.
In the latter half of the 1980s, Ford alternated between serious dramatic roles and light comedies. He made the thriller Frantic for director Roman Polanski, and the frothy comedy Working Girl, in which the deadpan Ford made a memorable straight man to Melanie Griffith and Sigourney Weaver. During these years, Ford and wife Melissa Matheson began a family of their own. Son Malcolm was born in March of 1987. Daughter Georgia would arrive 3 years later. During these years, the Fords purchased a ranch near Jackson Hole, Wyoming.
I like variety. I like what a city has to offer me, and I love what the country has to offer me, and I need kind of a mixture of the two.
Ford rounded out the decade by returning to Indiana Jones. This time, Sean Connery was on board as Indiana's father. In the 90s, Ford would play Washington insider Jack Ryan in two political thrillers. The first was Patriot Games.
Down! Get down! Ready! Get down! Keep her down!
Ann Archer played his wife in both Patriot Games and again in Clear and Present Danger.
He's very real. He's very there with everybody. And making movies is a group effort. It's a team. And it's important for a star and for all the actors to create a feeling of a team that we're all in this sort of private dance together.
James Earl Jones also co-starred in the two films.
I think all great actors expect a lot of their fellow actors, you know. Demand a lot, and sometimes gently, sometimes not so gently, but Harrison is very gentle about it.
Other roles in the 90s have included the redemption story Regarding Henry, about a ruthless lawyer's remarkable transformation following a head injury. He was Richard Kimball, the doctor falsely convicted of murder in The Fugitive. And in 1995 came a remake of the classic romantic comedy Sabrina for director Sidney Pollack.
He's got an enormous amount of just plain, ordinary, common sense, which is almost non-existent in our business.
That's an observation often made by Ford's friends, that and his sense of humor.
His humor is very droll and subtle.
He's not like your joke-telling person. It's more on a personal one-on-one level.
He says some of the greatest lines, I've spent a lot of time on the phone repeating the lines to other people because they make me laugh so hard.
In 1997, Ford was the president whose plane is hijacked in Air Force One, and he co-starred with Brad Pitt in The Devil's Own, a thriller about the Irish Republican Army. In 1998, it was back to romantic comedy in 6 Days, 7 Nights, opposite Anne Heche. Away from the cameras, Ford has been dividing time between homes in New York and Los Angeles and the ranch in Wyoming. The actor is a licensed pilot, a hobby he loves. Ford doesn't like to trade on his celebrity, but quietly supports environmental causes. Nearly half of his 800-acre property in Wyoming is in trust as a wildlife habitat. And when wife Melissa wrote a film about the Dalai Lama, Ford took up the cause. He testified before Congress and spoke out elsewhere on behalf of the exiled Buddhist leader, whose native Tibet has been brutalized by the Chinese since the 1949 invasion.
Despite His Holiness's pleas, his example of compassion and nonviolence, and the perseverance of himself and his countrymen, next to nothing has been done to lift that dark cloud and free Tibet.
He was Chicago born and bred, an aimless student with a hidden talent, a headstrong young man and confessed outsider who struggled for years refusing to conform. Much of Harrison Ford's everyman appeal springs from a uniquely American streak of individualism. His common sense and stubbornness to stand up for himself on the screen and in real life has helped make him one of the most enduring stars of the past quarter century. Now well into middle age and a grandfather, he retains that appeal to audiences hungry for stars they can relate to.
Men can look at him and say, yeah, that's me. They can identify with him, and women can look at him and think whatever the heck they're thinking.
He's a great guy, you know, and he's one of those kind of people that's interesting. You know, you can talk to him. He's got good ideas about things. And that's really what makes a friendship. You know, you can sit and talk about stuff.
10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years from now, we'll be talking about Harrison Ford films, and people will still be looking at them without question.
I think success has really helped Harrison. He's much more outgoing and friendly and lively and extroverted than he was then. And he just seems calmer and happier, and he has a very happy home life.
I really enjoy my life. I have great fun. I think my kids are going to have a great life. I am very touched and often buoyed by the expressions that I get from my customers of their satisfaction with the work that I do for them. And I'm very happy with the way things have turned out. There are things that are regrettable, and that, but you give them some context, and it seems a small price to pay for the pleasure that I get from my work, and the pleasure that I'm able to give other people through my work.